Hi, I'm Krista Brady, and today I'll be teaching you about the brain. Okay, this outer part of the brain that has all the ridges and grooves in it, this is called the cerebrum. And notice how there is a deep groove down the center of this. This is the longitudinal fissure, and that separates the cerebrum into two cerebral hemispheres. So we have the right cerebral hemisphere and the left cerebral hemisphere. Within the cerebrum has five lobes. The frontal lobe right here is right behind where your frontal bone would be. And then we have the parietal lobe right here. And the parietal lobe takes care of a lot of sensory functions. At the back, we have the occipital lobe, which is primarily responsible for your vision. Okay, going back to the side here, we have this lobe coming like the thumb of a large glove. This is the temporal lobe, right underneath where your temporal bone would be. There's one additional lobe, which we can't see from the outside. We can only see if you pull away the frontal lobe here. You can see inside the insula, also called the central lobe. On this model, I'm going to show you the lobes again. So we've got the frontal lobe here, the parietal lobe. At the back, we have the occipital lobe here. On the side, we have the temporal lobe coming out like the thumb of a glove. And then within the cerebrum deeper, we have the insula, or the central lobe, which is this internal lobe here, the fifth lobe. One other thing I'll point out on this model is that we've got some areas of what's called gray matter. It might appear kind of tan. And we've got some areas of white matter. The gray matter is areas that have a higher concentration of cell bodies. Remember, those cell bodies or somas of the neurons have lots of rough ER, which appears gray when you look at it from a wider perspective like this. And then these areas of white matter, these are primarily myelinated axons. Myelin is a fatty substance and it will appear white to our eyes. So I'll point that out here up here in the cerebrum. And then also this is the cerebellum. And notice there's lots of white matter there, white matter tracts that are traveling within the cerebellum. So it's very easy there to see the contrast between the white matter and the gray matter. We've talked about the overall structure of the brain, and now I want to talk about these fluid-filled cavities within the brain. These fluid-filled cavities are called ventricles, and they contain cerebrospinal fluid, or CSF. This model here is a representation of those cavities. So the plastic that you see here, this would not actually be solid structure within the brain, this would be a fluid-filled cavity. So imagine that somebody poured plastic into the ventricles, the fluid-filled spaces within my brain, and then melted away everything else. This is what you would be left with. So let's talk about what these ventricles are called. So you'll notice these large kind of C-shaped structures with a tail on either side. So you have, these are the lateral ventricles. You have a right lateral ventricle and a left lateral ventricle. They are connected by way of this little hole here. So remember that you're looking at gray plastic here, but in reality, this would be a fluid-filled hole. That little hole is called the interventricular foramen. Again, there are two. This one is the left interventricular foramen. On the other side, we have the right interventricular foramen. And those foramina will lead to this structure in the middle called the third ventricle. The third ventricle. And then we've got this long canal called the cerebral aqueduct that will lead to a diamond-shaped structure called the fourth ventricle, And from there, the cerebrospinal fluid will travel into the subarachnoid spaces within the meninges of the brain and spinal cord. One other thing that I'll point out here is that we've got this pink material. You can see pink material here on the left lateral ventricle. You can also see pink material on the third ventricle here, as well as on the fourth ventricle. That pink material is representing the choroid plexuses. The choroid plexuses are capillary beds that help to make the cerebrospinal fluid. Each ventricle has its own choroid plexus. So this is the choroid plexus of the third ventricle, and this is the choroid plexus of the fourth ventricle, and so on. So those are the ventricles, the fluid-filled cavities in the brain that hold cerebrospinal fluid. Now let's look again at the outside of the brain. So again, we're looking at the cerebrum here, and we've got all of these ridges and these indentations. The ridges, each ridge is called a gyrus, and each of these indentations is called a sulcus. So now I want to point one thing out, which is that we've got these relatively shallow indentations called, each one is called a sulcus, or plural is sulci. And then we've got these very deep indentations, like this one here. This is a fissure. This is the longitudinal fissure. And so how do you remember the difference between a fissure and a sulcus? Well, you will fall in a fissure, but you will just slip in a sulcus because a sulcus is not as deep. Now, there's a few specific gyri and sulci that you will need to know. One of them is this one between the frontal lobe and the temporal lobe. This is the lateral sulcus. And so that makes that distinction between these two lobes nice and obvious. There's another relatively clear sulcus here. This is the central sulcus, and it's highlighted on this model with different colors on either side to really make that stand out. On either side of the central sulcus, we have two major gyri. So the gyrus right here in front of the central sulcus is the precentral gyrus. The precentral gyrus is responsible for initiating your voluntary muscle movement. Behind the central sulcus, we have the postcentral gyrus. The postcentral gyrus is responsible for receiving general sensory information. So things like touch, temperature, pain, and proprioception information. And the central sulcus separates the frontal lobe from the parietal lobe. And then we have one more sulcus that is just barely visible on the outside here. And so I'm going to pull these two halves of this model apart and show it to you. So here's the parieto-occipital sulcus. So it's a little more obvious on the inside of this model here. So the parieto-occipital sulcus will separate the parietal lobe from the occipital lobe. So here we're looking at a different model of the brain. And I'm actually going to take off part of this model so we can look inside. And you'll see that we've got kind of this pink or salmon color running around the outside, and it goes into each sulcus and around each gyrus. That is representing the cerebral cortex, which is the outer part of the cerebrum. It's gray matter. So this is lots of cell bodies and dendrites and some unmyelinated axons all around that cerebral cortex. Your cerebral cortex is actually where your conscious awareness takes place. So conscious thought, conscious awareness of sensation, conscious decisions to make movements, that all takes place in that cerebral cortex, which runs all around the outside of all five cerebral lobes. Okay, we also have some gray matter that is internal to the cerebrum called the basal nuclei. We actually can't see that on this model, but they would be in this general area and they would be dark gray matter. Now we'll go ahead and talk about the structures of the diencephalon. The diencephalon is this inner part of the brain right about here. And so the largest part of this is the thalamus. The thalamus consists of two egg-shaped lobes. So you're seeing part of one of them right here. It's actually a lot bigger than it appears on this view. It will continue back farther to this, laterally to the side. And the two lobes of the thalamus are connected by this brown structure in the center. This is representing the intermediate mass, also called the interthalamic adhesion. So this is just a little piece of brain matter that will connect those two lobes of the thalamus. And the reason why they need to be connected is because there's actually fluid filling this area in between them. This is the third ventricle right in this space here. And then you can actually see the cerebral aqueduct coming along here to connect the third ventricle to the fourth ventricle, this diamond-shaped space right back here. So we've got the thalamus, which is the largest part of the diencephalon. And then in front of it and kind of below it, we have the hypothalamus, which is this somewhat triangular-shaped area right here, the hypothalamus. And then up above the thalamus, we have the epithalamus. The epithalamus is this salmon-colored structure in this model, and it ends in this little pinecone-shaped gland called the pineal gland. The pineal gland is a pinecone-shaped structure that is right above the arbor vitae, or tree of life, in the cerebellum here. That's all the white matter in the cerebellum right down here. So that can help you remember those structures, is that the pineal gland is the pine cone above the tree, the arbor vitae. Right above that epithalamus, you'll see this structure that has lots of blue and red in it. That's representing blood vessels. This is the choroid plexus of the third ventricle. So remember, the choroid plexus helps create CSF, and this is the one for the third ventricle that's right in this internal, right in the center of the brain here. Now, another part of the another part that's connected to the diencephalon is, notice we've got this little stalk right here, this thin little piece of matter that's reaching out to connect to this pink structure here. The pink structure is the pituitary gland, and this thin little stalk is the infundibulum of the brain. The infundibulum of the brain will connect the hypothalamus to the pituitary gland, both physically and functionally. So it allows the hypothalamus to send hormones and nerve impulses to the different parts of the pituitary gland to cause it to produce and release specific hormones. The pituitary gland will release hormones like oxytocin and ADH, which is antidiuretic hormone. And the reason why this is the infundibulum of the brain is because infundibulum is just a word that means a stalk or a thin, narrow connection. And so there's also an infundibulum of the stomach and an infundibulum of the uterus. So we just want to specify there that we're talking about the infundibulum that's located in the brain. And those are the structures of the diencephalon. And make sure you watch the lecture videos on the diencephalon, brainstem, and cerebellum to learn more about the function of the diencephalon. In this video, I've shown you the brain. We've talked about the overall structure of the brain, the lobes of the cerebrum. We've talked about the ventricles of the brain, and we've talked about structures that you'll find in the cerebrum and in the diencephalon. Now go ahead and practice these structures using the labeled and unlabeled images in your Learning Lab PowerPoint, and then you can apply these on the lab quizzes.